Hey, Millie, don't go nowhere. Sit down.
Is this an intervention?
No.
I know.
It's not. It's something I found on my desk. This is a something I found on the on my desk this morning. And I thought I'd read it to you guys. It says, "Letter from God to Women." Inspirational Christian story. "When I created the heavens and the earth, I spoke them into being. When I created man, I formed him and breathed life into his nostrils. But you, woman, I fashioned after I breathed the breath of life into man, because your nostrils are too delicate. I allowed a deep sleep to come over him so I could patiently and perfectly fashion you. Man was put to sleep so that he could not interfere with the creativity. From one bone I fashioned you. I chose the bones that protect to support him, as you are meant to do. Around this one bone I shaped you. I molded you. I created you perfectly and beautifully. Your characteristics are as the rib, strong yet delicate and fragile. You provide protection for the most delicate organ in man, his heart. His heart is the center of his being. His lungs hold the breath of life. The rib cage will allow itself to be broken before it will allow damage to the heart. Support the man as the rib cage supports the body. You were not taken from his feet to be under him, nor were you taken from his head to be above him. You were taken from his side to stand beside him and be held close to his side. You are my perfect angel. You are my beautiful little girl. You have grown to be a splendid woman of excellence, and my eyes fill when I see the virtues in your heart. Your eyes, don't change them. Your lips, how lovely when they part in prayer. Your nose, so gentle in touch. I've caressed your face in your deepest sleep. I've held your heart close to mine. Of all that lives and breathes, you are the most like me. Adam walked with me in the cool of the day, and yet he was lonely. He could not see me or touch me. He could only feel me. So everything I wanted Adam to share and experience with me, I fashioned in you. My holiness, my strength, my purity, my love, my protection and support. You are special because you are the extension of me. Man represents my image, woman, my emotions. Together you represent the totality of God. So man, treat women well. Love her, respect her, for she is fragile. In hurting her, you hurt me. What you do to her, you do to me. In crushing her, you only damage your own heart, the heart of your father, and the heart of her father. Woman, the power of emotion I have given you, and gentle quietness, show your strength. In love, show him that you are the rib that protects his inner self. Author unknown."
Wow.
Man. Oh, that was you, huh? Let's give the round of applause for God creating man and woman. Amen. Here's your preparation for worship. Heavenly Father, as the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forever. Holy Spirit, we welcome you here as we worship. Amen. Amen.
cuatro.
Good morning, everyone, and Linda. It's so nice to have you back. Yay. I hope you'll join us for the road trip this afternoon. Food at 1 and the road trip at 2. Will you join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
This is the call to assembly. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who makes us holy by accepting Yahshua Jesus and gives us the mitzvah, the duty of hearing the sound of the shofar. Where's Don?
Don will not be here. We need to pray for her mother to fall.
Oh. So should we sing next week for her?
Yes.
Yes, okay. We'll sing next week for her. All right, announcements. Ross is our new chief of security and safety, and he has an announcement about the CPR. Right?
Oh, yeah, we're going to get people in the on the safety team to get trained in CPR, and we're setting it up. It'll be in Moreno Valley, and anyone else in the church that wants to come and join us, they're welcome. For a $65 fee, you come and join us over in the Moreno Valley. It'll probably be here in about a month. But the security team itself is going to get trained just for safety purposes. And the rest of the congregation, feel free if you want to join us. That's up to you.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Excuse me.
I want to say thank you to all you people and how much I love you. And thank you for those prayers, because look at me. Yeah. They work. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Praise God.
Praise God. Thank you, Lord. That's awesome. Well, we'll skip all the Bible study stuff, right? You guys all have bulletins. You see the times. And for those of you that don't know who are watching, come to church. You'll find out.
There you go.
Amen. All right. Well, the ladies and or gentlemen who are going to help us with the offering, please come forward.
Will you bow your heads with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to give back to you all things that you give us in abundance. We praise you, Father in heaven, so you are so good to us. Take this gift from us, Father in heaven, and multiply it. We thank you for all things continually in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Worthy is the Lamb who was
little faster.
It's too draggy. Sorry, folks.
Little
just
faster.
Kidding.
A little up.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is the Lamb. Sing a new song, hymn set song. Heaven's mercy is the Lamb. Holy, holy, holy.
Okay. Sorry, guys.
Yeah, call it. Just cut it. Yeah. Just move on. It's okay.
Yeah. What is?
Sorry.
We'll try that again.
It happens. It happens. It's okay. Praise the Lord.
Jimmy, will you come and pray for the sick and the needy?
You know, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome. You know, I've learned a lot in my life, a lot of bad, yeah. A lot of good. I've learned a lot, I've listened to a lot, and I've got to learn discernment in my life, and I got to be able to see things going on in my life. And then I've got to kind of go out, step out of my comfort zone and do things that I'm not used to, and I found out that we don't have to be perfect.
Nope.
Huh?
No.
Sometimes it's the best thing that happens.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus, right?
Praise the Lord.
For the ability to not only be saved, but to be human and to start over when we mess up or whatever we do. I don't care. The greatest thing that I see today is that you're here in church. Your husband's here in church. Your kids are here with us in church. I'm sure you go to another church.
Your mom's here.
Oh, yeah, yeah. We're getting there. We're going to get there, okay? All right. So, but I just want to say that I've learned because I do a lot of that computer stuff, and it doesn't want to agree with me a lot of times. So, and I was getting frustrated and wanted to quit. I really did. And, you know, Ross told me, he goes, you know, we don't have to get it perfect. It doesn't have to be, you know, we just got to do it. Gotta do it. My mom is a walking miracle, right? A lot of us got that. We got these t-shirts. We got this bumper sticker that says, walk by faith, not by sight. Bam. Right? You need to slow down, though. I just want to know, I want everybody to know that's watching on the video and that is here in church today that we are a Jesus believing, praying, faithful church. And we live by the words we read in the Bible. Okay? And we believe that. And we, as a small church, get to prove it to the world that prayer works and miracles happen. So we just want to thank you. And we want to do, oh, I left my card. Okay, I'm just gonna, we want to lift up those out there, Lord God, that are, bow your hearts and heads with me. Those out there, Lord, that don't know you. that don't have this wonderful relationship that some of us here are just beginning, some of us here have had for a very long time, but they don't have that warm, comfortable feeling of a place called home, Lord God, where they can just close the door and give everything to you. I lift those people up to you right now that are struggling and worrying, suffering in this world, believing on the doorknob instead of you, Lord God. I want to lift them up to you, Lord. Those that do not believe, that do not want to believe right now, pierce the darkness of their heart, Lord God. Soften the rocks, make it mud so you can work with it, Lord God. I was a sinner out there, didn't believe in you, and boy, was I miserable because of it. I lift those up to you, Lord God. I want to thank you in advance for delivering those, Lord, that we pray for in our families, Lord God. I want to pray for my cousin Robert, who is separated not only from you, but his family, Lord God. It's just a real feeling. It's a raw feeling when we love those that are lost, Lord God, and we thank you for that. We want to lift up the people that are being healed today, Lord God, like my mom. Give them patience in their suffering, Lord God. Help them to reach out for the hem of your garment. Thank you for the ability to anoint and to pray for those people, Lord God. Thank you. Use us. Clean our hearts so we can be used by you, Lord God. We are my desire, and I assure many people sitting here today, is to be used by you to further your kingdom, Lord God. Help us not worry about what's going on with the government, what's on the TV. Let's worry about our families and our relationship with you, Lord God. I believe if we do that first, everything will follow. Thank you, Lord, for giving me the honor to pray for this church, Lord, daily. I appreciate you, Lord God. Thank you for my job that gives me that ability. You answered the prayers of my heart, and I thank you. I lift up anybody else that has a desire that hasn't been answered, that just keep on praying for it. It'll happen, Lord God. Thank you. Thank you for delivering us, Lord God. Thank you for connecting us where the separation was from the Father, Lord. I'm so happy to be here today. I just cannot believe the miracles that I get to see with my own eyes today. I was so blind for so long, and I thank you, Lord God, that I cannot wait for tomorrow to begin to do work for you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this church. Thank you for this pastor. Thank you for the studies that we get to do. But most of all, thank you for our ability to pray and our relationship that we have. And again, I do lift up those that are lost. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. For those that want to stand, stand. For those that want to sit, sit. Let's praise the Lord.
Faithful. Of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, and his righteousness unto children's children.
Thank you.
Jesus, I love you. Love you.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory from age to age. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's give the Lord a round of applause. And let's give our worship team a round of applause. Amen. Win, lose, or tie, Jesus till we die. All right. We're in Psalm 124, 125. These are the songs of ascents, or songs of degrees. And these are the psalms that the male Jews would have been, when they were required to go to Jerusalem three times a year, would have sang these songs on the road over there. Please bow your hearts with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and bless you to be able to come today in unity, to be able to praise your name, Lord, to make our requests known to you. Lord, just to worship you, Lord, for you are the one and only true God. We welcome your Ruach HaKodesh here this morning, Lord, to open up your word to our hearts and our minds, and to open up our hearts and our minds to your word, Lord. Please give us a hunger, Lord, to want to know you more, Lord. Give us a hunger to want to know your will and to surrender to your will, Lord. Help us, Lord, as we walk with you, Lord, as we seek you out, Lord, that we may be filled with the joy that only you can give, Lord, and a peace that only you can give, not as this world gives, but a peace that can that no one can completely understand, Lord. Lord, we bless you and we praise you, Lord, for your word. For your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path, Lord. Heavenly Father, we ask that you please, Lord, help us to remove everything from inside of us, Lord, that would distract you or displease you at this moment, Lord, that we will make room for you and your spirit to work, Lord, to give us understanding of your word, to reveal to us the mysteries of your word. Help us to be attentive to your word, and Lord, help us to retain what we share here this morning through your word, to be able to apply it to our lives, as well as in a loving way, help others apply it to their lives. In the mighty name of Yahushua HaMashiach, Jesus our Christ, amen. Psalm 124. The psalm reads, may the Lord bless the reading of his word. It says, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side. I was reading in the original Hebrew translation, and it doesn't read quite like this. It actually reads, had it not been Yahweh or Yahweh, or Lord, had it not been Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, had it not been Lord who was on our side. It's a better way of saying it. Had it not been God that was with us. In other words, in our plain English, had it not been God that was with us, God on our side. When God is on your side, it's God's spirit that moves only where there are people who will benefit from his presence. If the Lord had not been on our side, where would we be? Let's think about that question this morning. Where would you be had not God been on your side? I'd be a mess. I definitely would not be married. And I don't know where I would be. Nothing but his power, wisdom, mercy, goodness, kindness, and love could have guarded us from our enemies. Had it not been the Lord who was on our side. Verse 2. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side when men rose against us. Verse 3. They would have swallowed us alive with their wrath. They would have swallowed us alive when their wrath was kindled against us. Only the Lord can guard us from our enemies. Verse 3 again. They would have swallowed us alive when their wrath was kindled against us. Then the waters would have overwhelmed us. The stream would have gone over our soul. Then the swollen waters would have gone over our soul. This here is a picture when it says kindled against us. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. When they were about to get thrown into that furnace for the testing of their faith, that furnace was turned up 7 times hotter. Have you, as one confessing Jesus Christ, ever been in a situation where you feel like the heat's just been turned up a little hotter than usual? The pressure is on, the heat is on. It's not quite as hot as the last time, and it seems like it's been turned up 7 times hotter. 7 times hotter. Or have you ever been in the depths of a situation where it feels like you're drowning and you can't breathe, and it's very overwhelming, like a stream of mighty water knocking you down where it's hard for you to stand? Not that you have fallen, but it's hard for you to stand.
Last week.
Amen. Isaiah 43 puts it like this. Isaiah 43:1-2 says it like this. But now says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flames scorch you. We see this same picture here in this psalm. And you're probably wondering to yourself, yeah, that's all fine and dandy because that speaks to Israel. Right? When it says, hear, O Israel, O God of Jacob, O Israel. But here's a news flash. Because we have been grafted into Israel and we have been made partakers of that. And you'll find that in Romans 11:17. Well, we are grafted in, and we have been made partakers with Israel. All the benefits, all those blessings are ours to share with them. You see, we were grafted in to assist, to be a part of what God is doing. the waters, verse 4, would have overwhelmed us. The stream would have gone over our soul. Then the swollen waters would have gone over our soul. Have you ever looked to your past in your walk, and maybe not even in your walk, but before you became a Christian, and seen how many times God has helped you? You know, it's kind of like a little file cabinet you can go into and pull out this time, an event that happened, and say, Lord, you were with me. The Apostle Paul expresses it like this. In 2 Corinthians, verse 9 and 10 says, yes, we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead. You see, the God that we trust can raise the dead. He raised Jesus Christ, and that is our hope. That is our banner. That is the hope of the Christian walk, is in our promise of the resurrection. He goes on to say in verse 10, who delivered us from so great a death and does deliver us, in whom we trust that he will still deliver. In other words, he has delivered us in the past. God saw us through in the past. And we can be confident, we can be confident that he will see us through all the way till the end. God will complete what he started in your life. You are not too far gone. It may take time to get you up to where you were at, but he will not stop what he's trying to accomplish in your life. You know, it's funny that you read about in the Gospels, right, about these disciples and stuff, and there's small little hints there, like take, for instance, Peter, right? He denied the Lord three times, and he goes, and he's hiding after Jesus' crucifixion, and he's denied the Lord three times. When Jesus resurrects, and he tells Mary, or the angels tell Mary, go and tell the disciples, and he says, and Peter. It's a small hint, that Peter lost his discipleship in that moment. For a moment. Because that angel says, go and tell the disciples and Peter. He singled them out. And he gives him a little period of time to think about his walk, think about what he's doing. But when Jesus sees him on the beach and he tells him, hey, throw that net on the other side. They've been fishing all night long. Because Peter's like, oh, forget this, man. I'm going fishing. And they go fishing. They don't catch nothing. And that man on the beach says, throw the net on the other side. Right away, Peter was recognized and said, that's the Lord. And he jumped right into the water like always, head first. And it was on that beach, sometime later, after the denial, that Jesus asked him those three questions. Peter, do you love me? Do you agape me? Love me without condition. Peter says, yes, I love you, Lord. He asks him one more time, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. He says, feed my sheep. Tend to my lambs, feed my sheep. But on the third time, he says, Peter, do you love me? And it's a different type of love. It's a love called agapeo. And that word agapeo is what Jesus talks about, that men love the world rather than what they love God. In other words, they love their own desire. In other words, do you desire to love me? There's a difference between desiring to love and loving unconditionally. It's a desire to want to love God above all else. A desire to want to love what you do above all your selfish desires. That's what Jesus is really asking him. And he brings him back. He brings him back. Verse 6, Psalm 124. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us prey to their teeth. Sound the alarm. That's a good sign, right? Blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. This verse here implies that we can't be their prey unless the Lord permits it. You know, because everything that we go through, God allows. It's Father filtered. But he has given us to his Son, and his Son will not give us over to our enemies. If you're at the feet of Jesus daily, you will not be given over to the enemy. You may suffer some trial and tribulations and some really tough testings, but you won't be given over to the enemy. It's made to build you up, to help you stand stronger, to increase your faith. Verse 7. Our soul has escaped as a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Take some time to get familiar of the different characters and attributes of God when you pray. Give him credit for who he is. When you say you love him, tell him why you love him. Tell him why you love him. Is it because he's merciful you love him? Is it because he is ever loving that you love him? Or is it because he's the creator of the universe, the heavens, the earth, the sea, El Elyon? Is that why you love him? Is that why you seek his help? He has many, 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 many attributes, many, 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 many names. Is it because he's wonderful? Is it because he's your counselor when you didn't know what you were thinking or doing or couldn't decide, and he gave you that wisdom? Is it because you were afraid and he gave you that courage and that strength? And you say, Lord, I love you because of this. It's those different characters. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our soul has escaped. Escaped what? Escaped slavery. We've escaped guilt, corruption, vain deceit. We've escaped pride. We've escaped bad habits. We've escaped dominion of sin. We've escaped fascination of Satan. And all that could destroy us, we've escaped. We've escaped those things. Because our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. And that is where our faith lies. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 and 18, it's one of my favorite passages, but I'm going to read it to you in the contemporary English. It says, we are like clay jars which this treasure is stored. The real power comes from God and not from us. We often suffer, but we are never crushed. Even when we don't know what to do, we never give up. In times of trouble, God is with us, and when we are knocked down, we get up again. We face death every day because of Jesus. Our bodies show what his death was like so that his life can also be seen in us. This means that death is working in us, but life is working in you. In the scriptures it says, I spoke because I had faith. We have had the same kind of faith, so we speak because we know that God raised the Lord Jesus to life. And just as God raised Jesus, he will also raise us to life. Then he will bring us into his presence together with you. All of this has been done for you so that more and more people will know how kind God is and will praise and honor him. I love it the way that translation puts it. And that's the way it is when we put our trust, when we trust in the Lord and know that our help is in the name of the Lord. Amen? Psalm 125. Those that trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved but abides forever. Those that trust in the Lord are chosen of the Lord. Many are called, few are chosen, Jesus says. There's many people who are called to salvation, but few are chosen. How do you know that you're chosen of God? You know, because when you trust in the Lord, no matter what comes your way, no matter what attacks you, no matter what temptations there are, you know you cannot be moved. You are like Mount Zion, strong. You stand your ground. You don't let the enemy have a foothold in you. You trust in the Lord. You could recognize those who are chosen because they will not move. What a privilege it is to be allowed to rest with the Lord, to have peace and a calm in God. Just as the Lord sits as king forever, so his people sit enthroned with him in the heavenlies with perfect peace when their trust is in him is firm. Verse 2, as the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forever. So not only are God's people who trust in him, they are like a mountain, but they are also surrounded with the mountain. They have a protection over them. A double security. We are made like a mountain and then protected as if by mountains. And it's not temporary. It's a privilege. But this privilege is so forever. It's his promise. You get a double blessing here. When you trust in the Lord and you stand your ground and you stay firm, not only are you like a mountain, but you have mountains surrounding you. You have a fortified wall around you. How many of you desire to have a fortified wall of protection over you that no matter what happens, you know you're protected? And the first step is in trusting in the Lord. Trusting him in everything. Not trusting in your own ability. Not trusting in what your neighbor tells you. Or not trusting in what manly advice can give you. But trusting in what God wants for you and your life. And then you'll be able to stand like that mountain and have a wall around you of protection. It's here. It's a promise of God. This is what we stand on. We stand on God's promises. We stand on God's promises. Verse 3. For the scepter of wickedness shall not rest on the land allotted to the righteous. Lest the righteous reach out their hands to iniquity. So that scepter of wickedness won't rest. That evil one, Hasatan, won't rest. The world that we live in won't rest. That old soul that we have to deal with, that old self, won't rest. We have to train that old soul. We have to live in the world and not be of the world. And we have to be strong when it comes to the enemy's attacks and know that Jesus took away that power from him on the cross. He stripped him, made a spectacle of them. And we are not to give the enemy power. Because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Amen? I'm going to take you to Matthew 12, verse 43. Because here in the psalm it says, lest the righteous reach out their hands to iniquity. Because there's only a certain amount of influence or temptation that the enemy can do. And you have the power to be strong over it. And you got to learn how to remain a clean vessel. And here in Matthew 12, starting in verse 33, Jesus talks about this little teaching. And it says, when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest and finds none. Then he says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it empty, swept, and put in order. Then he goes and takes with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. So it shall be with this wicked generation. You know, there's a consequence to when you're walking with the Lord, and you're being with him, and you're standing firm and standing strong, when you choose to reach out to wickedness. Because you're just opening up the door to even more wicked spirits to come in and influence you, and then your state ends up worse than it was the first. But it's a choice we have. It's a choice we have. We have to remain clean vessels. We must not yield to evil pressure. We must yield to the Holy Spirit, but not yield to evil pressure or get lazy and be driven to our own vengeance or our own self-deliverance. We need to depend on the Lord to deliver us and stand on his word for our protection, just like Jesus Christ when he fought off the evil one. He said, it is written, it is written, it is written. Just because we have the Lord's protection doesn't mean we won't face trials and tribulations. It's our personal duty to guard our heart. Amen? Guard it at all costs. He's given you a new heart. Don't let it get tainted. Don't let it get tainted. You'll be surprised what the Lord can do through a clean heart. And that's all it takes. You know, you truly want to live that life of the Lord. Have that heart clean. Be at Jesus' feet and find out what his will is for your life and be devoted to him. You don't have to try and do good works because it will happen automatically. He just needs a clean vessel to use it. You ever wonder why certain people get used and some don't? Look at the fruit that they're producing. Look at the fruit of their life. Look at how clean that vessel is, the inside of their heart. Everybody has their individual walk. You all have a calling. Everybody was made on purpose for a purpose, but it's up to us to choose to want to remain a clean vessel. And when we do fall short, we have to repent and ask God for forgiveness. And he will wipe away all that unrighteousness. And he will create in you again a clean heart. Just like David said in Psalm 51, create in me a clean heart, O Lord. Amen? Verse 4, do good, O Lord, to those who are good and to those who are upright in their hearts. Faith in God is good. And those who trust in the Lord are good and upright. Righteousness comes from faith and the evidence of uprightness. Verse 5, as for such as turn aside to their crooked ways, the Lord shall lead them away with the workers of iniquity. You know how sad it is when believers who once walked in that right way should choose to turn aside from it. That is for our job as brothers and sisters in the Lord to pray for them, to truly pray for them. Do you know of people who have turned away? Is your heart there to pray for them? Do you desire that they come back? You know, because Jesus asked them to come back, to draw them back. Or do you know someone that's lost, that you desire anything more in your heart to know that, man, if they just knew the Lord? I have a friend that I seen yesterday, and I was so joyful, man, when I seen him. Because I didn't know that he was now saved. I knew him, and it was the kind of guy that you didn't want to cross. He's one of those interesting characters, right? But I was worried about him, and I've been praying for him. And when I seen him, I gave him a hug. We started talking. And he says, yeah, I go to the Way World Outreach. And I was like, and he says, all my friends are like, you? Yes, even God can rescue you. Prayer is very powerful. Prayer is very powerful. And we see our brothers and sisters and those who we desire that, if Lord, if they would just come to the Lord, we don't want no one to perish. I know God doesn't want no one to perish, but we have a duty to do, and we have a duty to pray. And if that prayer includes us changing our thinking as well, we need to do that. There's times when God has to change my thinking and how I perceive things, where he has to soften my heart. And I have to agree and say, hey, Lord, your will be done, not mine. Peace be upon Israel. You guys pray for the peace of Israel? Yes? No? Right? Yep, me too. Once in the morning and once at night and sometimes during the day. He or she who has peace with God may enjoy peace in all things. Nice. Amen? Yeah. Bow your hearts with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and we bless you, Lord. Because, Lord, sometimes it takes us more time than others, Lord. Sometimes it takes some of us 30 years to learn how to stand strong in you, to learn how to trust in you, to learn how to stand as your mountain, as Mount Zion, Lord. And Lord Jesus said it like this. No matter what time you come to salvation, it's all salvation. So Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would put it upon our hearts, Lord, to pray for the salvation of those that are lost. That you would put it in our hearts to pray for those that have strayed away. That you would put it on our hearts, Lord, to help us keep to that straight and narrow path, and that your Holy Spirit would correct us when we are wrong, to help us remain clean vessels, Lord, that we may be your instruments, your vessels for your use, for your honor, for your glory, Lord, that we may be unity, Lord, a unity church, Lord, in one, in Christ, with each other. And we ask all this in the precious name of our Lord and our Savior, Yahshua HaMashiach, Jesus our Christ. Amen. Love one another. pray for, and forgive one another always, and do it. Forget the road trip, 1 o'clock, the McGinnis house, and then 2 o'clock, the showing.
incredibly.